I'd like to welcome you back to this art series at a series of artists' presentations at the AA. And I'll hand over in a moment to Pavin, who's kind of organizing the series and who will introduce this evening's artist. But I did want to thank the fact that the London Consortium has made it kind of financially possible to have these lectures, and we're very grateful to them. So I welcome Pavin, who can introduce the speaker.
Wrong moment, I think. I actually have very little to say at the moment, except this is Ján Mancuska. He works in Prague. And the reason I know his work was because we were in New York and were told to go and see it at Andrew Krepp's 2 years ago. And it is extremely interesting, the work that I saw. It was strips of sentences about eye height, crisscrossing each other in a very spare, not too large room. And as you read across the strips, you got different kinds of sentences depending on whether you turned an angle or whether you didn't. And a story built up out of this. But what was really interesting, I thought, was that it was less about space than about the construction of an event. Because you could see, for example, the word man appearing in various places in the room, since the story also repeated itself. So of course the man wasn't any one physical space, but the story, as it were, unfolded. And the story then that you got at the end was, of course, not complete. It carried within it the kind of fragmentation that had been the conditions of its construction. And a very similar piece, but not nearly as effective, it was not as large, not as tall, was shown in Frieze last summer as well. And since then, I have merely seen a catalogue where he worked with somebody who came here 2 years ago. I think I mentioned this person, Jonas Dahlberg, and they did a collaboration, which was extremely interesting across the work of both of them. They took pieces they already had done to some extent, used this work, one visual images, one text, across several rooms, down a corridor, but I'll let you describe it. The thing about the work really is that the kind of disorientation it produces lasts even through my reading this catalogue 3, 4, 5 times. Very carefully, I knew exactly which room, what happened, and at the end, I am subject to exactly the kind of disorientation that I assume was the desired effect. Okay, I'll let him explain it all, and we'll have some questions at the end. So please welcome Jan.
Hello. So I divided my lecture in several blocks. The first is like my working mainly with the text and text in the space. And I will show you several like systems or approaches as is possible to sort of like the think on space like and on the text as a sort of like object or as something that organizes the space. So this is actually my first show in Andrew Krepp's gallery. And it's also one of the first works I started to so like use the text. And it's like 2004. And basically it's the former space of the gallery was a white cube type of space, exhibition space. And I divided that space into two parts with this wall, as you see. And I used this like a laser cut. And I cut out the letters. So the letters, this text was basically the holes. Like, so the only chance how to sort of like look behind the wall was the text itself. And I posed in front of this wall, I posed the light bulb. And the light went through the text and described actually the space behind. So you can also, when you sort of like outside or in front of the wall, you can read the text. And actually then actually is the content of the text fulfilled by the objects, which is sort of like it was for me, my work, or I would love to sort of like work in the way that each piece has like several layers, and it depends on you how sort of like you sort of like approach the piece. And one layer was so like for me, like, or content was this connection, like connection of language and so like thinking or perception, which is very like definitely deep question. Also, actually, suddenly you have like, for instance, that moment when there is a frame, and like the sort of like text says, 1.5 meters from the floor, a picture hangs. So actually, the only content of the frame was this light inscription. And like next piece in the show was this chair. I put stand the chair in front of the wall, and I took a gun, or air gun, BB gun, and I started to shoot against the chair. And then actually I pulled the chair out, so like suddenly this absence of the object was the like the main subject of the content. And for me it's also sort of like this absence, it's like for me very important notion in my work, because as I would say, this type of sort of like description of the object is sort of like even more precise. If you would imagine, for instance, the target, which is this is also the target, and you shoot on it, and then actually you will pull it out, so that the shape of the target or shape of the chair is like the description of the object is so precise because of this, like. It's not the outline. It's something which is sort of like more generous, and it's like gaps in between the bullets. That's sort of like what brings this precision into the object. This is the next piece which I start like work with when I'm. It's nearly the same. Yeah, the same period, and it's a sort of like print on the rubber band. And this is the text. The text describes my walk through the studio, which I had in New York. And what is important is the 25 points font, the sentence has exactly the same measurements as my walk, which I was sort of like measuring in the studio. So basically, the language or the sort of graphic record of language keeps the physical measurements. And I did. This thing that I printed it on the flexible material, so like suddenly there was a chance to always actually so like stretch it, yeah. So it was for me somehow also working with this like the idea of the exhibition space, you know, because like it keeps like real measurements of sort of like the action I describe, the walk, but so you can always so like make it up to the like the space in which you sort of like. Show the piece, so it's sort of like it's for me somehow the critique of this virtuality of the exhibition space, which is various like specific problematics in contemporary art somehow, like what it is exhibition space and what is like actually shown in exhibition space. I can show you more, so like more ways how I shown it. It's like this is in Jan Mot in Brussels. Important is like this actually text when it describes sort of like my walk through the room of my studio. So there is like a description of the objects which I had in the studio, and there is also like the description of where I am actually at the moment of describing. So when, for instance, there is a mention that I approach the wall, so it's I fixed it into like wall. So actually, then actually you do the sort of like the same thing when you read it. You do the same sort of like thing, or you repeat it after me, what I did. So it's like more, let's say, performative piece than the object itself, because like people sort of like yeah. Also like that there's this moment when people read it and they can sort of like identify their momental position with what is written, which is sort of like it's like fulfills also this. Somehow the space of the like exhibition, of the gallery. And what is important also, which is for me, so like this very typical, somehow typical to work with this loop type of narration. So So this moment is then actually it ends when I started, and there is actually the last sentence says that I returned to the same place where I started and tried again. And that's very important thing, because I call this moment like permanent critique, because if I would do the same action again, so of course I will repeat, like I will describe the other objects, I will sort of like tend to sort of like say something else. And this is sort of for me sort of like a very interesting pattern of like recent, like let's say society or orientation in society, is this like never-ending like critique, permanent critique, which sort of like brings to like experience completely different role than before. For instance, like when you see the, like it in a historical point of view. And this is actually the show which Parvin was talking about. Basically, this is the floor plan. I did like the three texts, and what is important is like the, because there is sort of like two points from where I was started to work on the piece, and one is actually the, so like the narration itself. Like I, in one moment, I started to collect the stories which I heard from my friends, relatives, so it was sort of like always the true story. And for these stories, I always try to sort of like invent the like specific way how to sort of like show it in a space. And this is the floor plan of this thing. It's a sort of like aluminum letters which are stretched among the walls, and the height of my sort of like eyes of my horizon. So it's like 163 centimeters above the floor. So what is very important is that when you so like get into the room, so you see first the line, which is this for me the timeline, because the sort of like it deals a lot with the time. And then this is the floor plan of the whole installation. And what is important is that I created the sentences the way that. So like one sentence was representing always the one character, telling the same story. So the story was told by three characters. And each character was sort of like differently posed in a time. And the story is about my schoolmate. She was not from Prague. She was traveling to Prague to like very often in the train. And once she was raped in a train. And the story and is described by her as a victim. Then almost immediate witness, the old lady who came to the train compartment just after it happened. And then it's my actually line, and sort of like I describe what I heard from my schoolmate. And what is important is that like, so each line represents one character, but actually they are crossing. And in the moment when you cross, when they cross the wires or the text, you can switch to the sentence. So actually, and it sort of like makes sense. It's so like it's still like the sentence. So suddenly when you switch one character, you switch the character psychology, but you switch also the time, because there are these three types of timing. And there is finally the I think 13 possibilities to read one story. And what is also important is like this moment of decision, because it's sort of like up to you when you walk through the installation, how you're gonna read it. This like decision, I understand also sort of like very politically, because this sort of like the way when it's your minor possibility to influence the, so it is like surrounding run of the society somehow. And this is the story. So it's like first it's the victim, the second is the witness, and the third is me. And first time, this is actually the show in Andrew Kress, but the first time it was in the Stedelijk Museum, Amsterdam, and it was this text which you read. But the second time I created the other type of the story, when also like characters were like, so like being described like in a one moment. So it was sort of like one moment situation when always was like the end or the psychological, so like the the result was psychological, so like life was always a bit different. That would look like. And also what is interesting actually, which I will show you also in the next work, is that this line, when you work with a text in a space, it sort of like has certain qualities, and one very so like simple and very basic qualities that of course we read from left to right. So you immediately sort of like create the sort of like the way how the space is sort of like used, because you sort of like use the space to read the text, read the piece. So it's like immediately it's like created by this like simple fact from left to right. And maybe I'll go here. I did like this piece, which is this was on the stairs. And it is exactly the moment when you sort of like you totally create your way, how you wanna sort of like people let walk through the space, because it's sort of like the way of it's the little bit different type. There is no narration. It's sort of like this internet type of the description. When I started with like describing one simple object, which is in this case a cup. And then actually I was sort of like always dividing like the possibilities of this description into several types of, so you can talk about material function, let's say shape, and then it grows and grows, and from the simple object actually you get into the more detailed things, because through the material you can get to the liquid, and liquid is sort of like let's say a tea, and then actually it grows like what is tea, and actually you can, it's very performative thing. Also I decided that I will sort of like do all installation the day of the opening, so I started like early morning when the first spectators came. I stopped, so it was sort of like the fragment which was influenced by sort of like also simple fact that there is like the spectators already. And so like it was sort of like more not my decision, but like the decision of random of the surroundings. And what is important is this, like that sort of like when you read it, you know, you can sort of like of course always read like the sort of like you always choose your way. So it's again this decision, but it's very difficult to sort of like to sort of like get back in the same way. So it's always, I mean, it's always the way how you read it is like never the same, because and I did this thing like once on the stairs, which was sort of like the stairs in like the whole exhibition space in Prague, and it was very interesting because like the way how you sort of like walk up, it's it was like this direction, so I had to sort of like use the way that you got up and then you read it back, you know. So it was sort of like the very important for whole setup of the show, because suddenly we had like the piece which was sort of like taking people out of the show, which is always very like difficult to sort of like create the whole setup of the show that it sort of like makes sense all the time, like that it's not this blank, for instance, way back, or also this like the strange times of like institutional spaces like stairs are always so like empty and stuff like that. So it was sort of like very interesting, and also it's so like for instance, it's big difference between this, which is sort of like I started with a different notion. There was like on the stairs it was a chair, here it's a cup, but sort of like the system was similar, but like the whole feeling from the piece was completely different. Now I can show you the two different types of thinking on the space of the gallery. There's a sort of like very simple object of like wooden relief of a chair on the wall, and then I use the beamer projection from up, which sort of like made this shadow, which is all like, of course, see that it's coming outside. It's coming outside from outside to the gallery. It's sort of like a little bit, it's also the critique of this artificial character of the like exhibition space, which is sort of like the artist, what makes the life more interesting interesting than the art. So it's this idea. This is the sort of like the very similar idea, but I work with the text. It's sort of like, again, this description of the walk from one wall to the other, and part of the text is sort of like hidden, like taken by or projected by a beamer. Part is like physical. So yeah, I mean, for me, wall was always sort of like, you know, it's so like very similar like type of space as, for instance, in a drawing, because like there is big difference between the painting and drawing. Yeah, the painting is always sort of like within the somehow the frame, even not physical frame, but it's always sort of like the. So you have to always think about the composition, and it has like long tradition in history. But the sort of like the drawing always deal with this like emptiness. So the sheet of the paper is rather emptiness than the frame, and the wall for me is like has the similar character, this emptiness, you know, and that's sort of like very interesting. Like you can sort of like also remark that, for instance, like in like this like conceptual artists like in like the 60s, 70s, they like of course never like there's few paintings, but they had like they're drawing a lot. I think it's because it's this type of emptiness which sort of like brings certain quality of freedom. This is actually, I used in this installation, which is the Venice Biennial last or year or yeah, year 2005. I used a similar so like the idea of this type of description that it so like starts with like initial word and then it grows in certain segment or fragment of word, which, you know, if I would, it's also like the fact that I did this similar so like installation several times and it was always different, you know, because you want to always be more precise and more precise, so you sort of like work and it's like finally it's very so like based on your momental situation. So then I so like made it a little contrary, so I printed it on the plexiglass sheets and I did it in three layers. So it was like half and like there was like certain space in between of the sheets, and when you were in certain position, it's like the in a simpler case. It was like sort of like a smaller piece which I did with the system. So when you stand in a certain position, you can read it. Yeah, but when actually you move, so it's all because it's sort of like in layers. So it all sort of like this. Dismantles, you know, it disappears, and it's very important for me. It is like so, like the also in terms of like theory of art is like position of you, you know, position which you allows you to sort of to understand somehow, and yeah. So what is also important is like or interesting is that of course you have to sort of like count on the perspective. So what is more further must be like bigger than in like. Thanks to perspective, then it appears in the same size. And then I did this. It was quite a big installation. And you can see that from a certain point of view, you can read it in proper, so like, yeah, proper row. But when you so like lose your point of view, so then it actually gets totally abstract, which is also very, very interesting because it's sort of like, yeah, because like, I mean, there is this initial word, so like each word which is more in like further has certain relation to the like first word. So it's sort of like even now you lost your sort of like point of view, like thanks to this like random meeting of the words, it's sort of like it always makes sense somehow. Yeah, so it's sort of like almost like automatic poetry or something. Then like by up to do like the your position, which is like so like. Up to your, I don't know, wandering in a space, it actually creates a certain combination of the like words, and it sometimes it was very interesting what you were able to sort of like read thanks to this like angles and distance, and you could also of course walk through, and it's the other thing. you can walk through, and also you could see it from backwards, which was like totally abstract afterwards. So that was like a couple of like several types of how I work with the text, and the let's say it's always a little bit different, and I use always like different possibility of working with the text, like in terms of like the narration, but also in terms of like organizing the space. This was actually the show, this one, which we did collaboratively with Jonas Dahlberg, who had also lecture here, as Marvin mentioned. And this is completely different type of the using the text. So, I mean, like, first we decided that in this, like, main hall of the Bonner Kunstverein, it was in Bonn, 2005. So we will make, like, from this aluminium letters, two screens. And we decided that we both will not use the new, sort of like new text. I use the old text. He, like Jonas, used the old films. So actually the whole, the type of our collaboration will be layering. So I, from my old text, created the screens, and he projected the films on it. And like the sort of like the, yeah, maybe some of you knows like, his work, it's sort of like he always shows the models, and in models it's sort of like interiors of the rooms, and he works a lot with light. So and one actually film was like horizontal sliding, so the movement of this like position of the camera was like this way, and the other was like vertical, so it like the film was like going down. So the whole feeling from the space, you can see that it was sort of like two in front of each other. Was sort of like very strange, because the films were sort of like creating this motion in the space, and also the way how you actually were able to read the text was different, because as you see, like this is for instance the very sort of like light situation, but sometimes there it was like complete dark frames of the like film, and then it was like for instance just rectangle of the door was like light. So actually you read this text thanks to like possibilities of the light situation, thanks to the film somehow. So suddenly it was totally like actually breaking through of this linear character of the reading of the text, and so like you were like reading the segments, and you were trying to sort of like compare somehow the lines, and so like the way how you got the content of this, like the text was completely different than in terms of like the linear reading. And also what was sort of like interesting in terms of the art, word or like system of this like art market or something, it's like that, like we created like new piece from two already existing, and of course like in the gallery system like existing and sold somehow the works, and suddenly just like this combination of these two layers was like created a new piece. So it for me it was like we sort of like started to use a little bit this like notion of ready-made, but completely different, and it was used in, for instance, in context of Duchamp or whatever. And then this was the main sort of like room, so this like the light coming through of the text was really nice, because then you had actually one image on the screen, one image in the like much bigger scale in a back wall, and then also the like suddenly the size of the letters also created this feeling of almost like propaganda way of like or type of sort of like language. This is the text, one of the texts. It's for me very important text. It's as I said, it's on one of the screens, and it deals a lot with the time and with the memory, and so if you have a patience to like read it, it's sort of like important, or maybe at least a part of it. And then actually maybe I'll switch. This is how it looked like. And that's actually the There was the main hall, and the rest of the gallery we were, because the gallery was before the construction, so we had a chance to sort of like work really with halls, so like floor plan of a gallery. So we created a couple of moments which were very similar to the like the what was actually shown in the, like Jonas' films in the real scale, which was very interesting. So this is the corridor which we sort of like also, because we divided the show into some parts which were so like pieces, and this is like the corridor. And then actually the other type of a collaboration which I'll show you like as in next image was that I sort of like made like text, the text, and Jonas created the environment for the text, and the piece is called Cinema One, and there's a sound.
I woke up, startled by a loud noise, absolutely no idea where I was. I'd probably fallen asleep. The flashes of light randomly illuminated the contours of the surrounding figures. People again laughed loudly. I fixed my eyes on the screen and comfortably sat back in the seat. I'm in the cinema. I'll comfortably sit back in the seat, fix my eyes on the screen, and people will again laugh loudly. The contours of the surrounding figures will be randomly illuminated by flashes of light. I'll look around me. I'll probably fall asleep with absolutely no idea where I am. Startled by a loud noise, I will wake up.
And on the screen there was like only black light. I mean, the black in terms of like the beamer projection is still light, so it was sort of like floating frame of the screen. And there was this like cinema environment. Yeah, it was very nice because then when you were sitting, sorry, you became to be sort of like the subject somehow. This is the next, actually, piece which I did in Berlin Biennial last year. And it's again this like type of working which uses this layers. So I stretch the letters into space. And then I put the bulb in front of it. Ah, fuck. Sorry, I did a mistake. Sorry. Bad move. Yeah, this is the bulb. And the text actually was illuminated by the light, and it created the shadows on the back wall. And the shadows actually were so like the readable, and I fill the gaps between the shadows with the handwriting. And what is important is that if you so like again in a certain position, so you can read, because it's again in eye level, the text, so you can read the first, so like this, like the aluminum letters as one sentence, which says sort of like very everyday action on the street. And then actually the back text is so like the same action, but with a sort of like inner life of the main character. And it's the story of my mother, and she was sort of like at home, and her sister called her and told her that her dad is sort of like in a hospital after brain stroke. So it was like he was old, and so like she was so like, yeah, she was expecting that. So she sort of like started to do afterwards sort of like everyday needs, and then she went to the shop to buy some like I know bread or whatever, and then the saleswoman, she wasn't like, she didn't understand her, so she was like confused, and outside on the street she realized that she spoke Russian, and she didn't use Russian since she was in a like basic school. So it's sort of like this like very inner type of like psychology. So you have like in aluminum letters you have very simple description, and she was at home, then she went to the shop to buy, and then she's standing on the street, and then you have this handwriting which is describing this like inner life of the main character. It's again sort of like the true story, right? So it's so like it keeps this concept of like at the beginning when I started to work with the narration, I was not really interested into fiction. I was rather interested into so like the yeah the things which are very everyday, which are even from the people which I closely know. And I was always dealing with the way how I can sort of like work with the narration and how it looked like. Yeah, and this is actually, for me, it's the oldest work, actually. It's like 2003, and it's the so like next part which I want to talk about, and it's so like the time. And this is called like Time in Sequences, You Never See It All. And it's like sort of like one object, the table with two chairs. And if you imagine this sort of like table with the two chairs, and you are trying to sort of like catch it into the frame of a camera, but you are, you don't have like proper distance, so it's always just a part of it in the frame. So you have to use this sort of like the frames as it is in film tape to sort of like catch it all. And then actually it's a very interesting thing that in sort of like your, because this is the way as sort of like is your perception is sort of like working, is that you always observe the details. And there is sort of like some measurement in your brain which sort of like allows you to like understand those details in the whole. And yeah, this moment is like for me very, very interesting. And this was the first work which I started sort of like deal. And then I created for this sort of like character of the brain, because you have several possibilities. Like in film also, for instance, editing is something which actually makes details into like, or puts details into the sort of like whole somehow, yeah. And then I created for me a very important notion, which I called the dramatic curve. It's then when I was I did my own research, sort of like, and like, what is the memory? What is the character memory? So if you imagine, so like, you have this sort of like sense of continuity, but of course, like, you have very selective memory because you can also like remember all, and also it's like different types of a memory. So you. And like remember only the fragments, but those fragments are not just like so like from here to here from the continuity, but those fragments have always the dramatic quality to be comprehensible somehow. So actually it was sort of for me so like feedback to the what I had for to my so like the text installations, that this sort of like the idea of like dramatic character of the memory, and also actually deals a lot with the history, for instance, which is also the construct of the past. It's not the past, of course. And this is one of the drawings I did as a sort of like the, yeah, this for dramatic curve. This is the show I did in Berlin, Kunsthaus Bethanien. And so like, four sequences, showing always the couch or sofa, table and a TV. This is a floor plan of it. So again, here the sort of like the exhibition space is sort of like a frame, which is again the critique somehow of the what it is exhibition space. So you see that one sofa is cut in the middle, and because it was sort of like out of the frame, and you can.
When I'm in this room, it always reminds me of the story about Eva and her potential partner, psychiatrist. When he would lie on his side and watch TV, he would turn the TV and put it on its side too, so that watching was more comfortable for him. She makes this particular point to justify why she split up with him. Eva still lives alone. I tried it also a couple of times, but I realized that I'm too limited by gravity.
So it was the story, and it divided the story into four sequences, and it, so like the sound was jumping from one TV to the other. So you actually, your orientation through the space was like that you follow the sort of like the sound of the story. So each sequence had its own part of the story. And the story deals a lot, for instance, with the theory of image also, because like in Western sort of like tradition of the image, you have, it's very important what is like on the left side, on the right side, because that's the way how we read, how we, and also what is down is, and what is up is sort of like that, so like this traditional like limits of the of the creating of the image, and it's sort of like when you have it destroyed by this simple fact that it's like on its side, so suddenly it creates completely different feeling of the like perception of like it's almost physical feeling of a perception of the image. So the image was always the same in each TV, and so like because I was shooting it like in several layers, so there was this spiral type of creating the space, because then the TV was also on its side, and TV in the TV was again on its side, so it had this like it's like never ending spiral into the monitor. That's the frame of the exhibition space. This is actually belongs to the discrossing letters. I was trying to sort of like also create the other type of how I sort of like can show what happened, like the action on the street, and I used as it was sort of like the story was like the action on the street, but I used that as a sort of like floor plan the gallery, so it's sort of like also the drawing. This is the amount of water I was able to hold in my mouth without it vanishing, so it's like water and it goes down, and it was specially created for the art fair, because like when it was sold it was empty already, so basically they bought like empty glass. That's also with this shooting chair, it was also like to offer beautiful wall, for instance. And this is like the drawings which sort of like create like I was trying to sort of like perform this moment when you sort of like doing a lot of actions and sort of like in one, and it's very difficult to sort of like the memory works that you sort of like always select or put this like small things into something which sort of like makes some whole things to the dramatic character of the memory. This psychological type of maybe it's very autobiographic, but it's the other version. Okay, and this is then we can sort of like see the first film, and this is the work I did in Art Unlimited in Basel. And it's basically two 35 millimeter projectors facing each other. And the tape is running from one to the other end back again, so it's loop. And actually, whatever is very important is that actually the one image shows, projects the so like the projector projects the image into in the gate of the other. So this was actually the image was one to one to the real frame on the film tape. So it was like completely, I started like from, it's maybe obvious that when I was busy with the narration, so like started to also think about the film as a like one medium which sort of like work with the narration. And this is actually also dealing with like the space and what the position of the spectator. So you had like the chance to see it like, because like it was very small, and also I mean the room of the whole thing was very sort of like big, and it was like the noise from the projectors was very noisy, and so like actually it was very it was really wondering, because you knew that something is happening because there is sort of like soundtrack and everything, so everyone was sort of like searching, and suddenly then they see this like small image, and it was sort of like very beautiful, because it's also like it talks a lot about the spectacularity, because like this big screen is of course to like have a chance to see it, to be seen by as many people as you can, but like this small image is so like enough, you can recognize everything, like the mimics of the face, everything, so and suddenly you had this chance to be like one to one, like very in a very intimate position with something, with the so like the motion picture. And I used really so like narration in the film, which is very so like classic, with this introduction, like main part and punchline. And we can sort of like see it afterwards. But like I wanted to say that sort of like the piece consists from three parts. This space, which is sort of like dark with this like curtain, and this sort of like has the symbolics of the, let's say, a cinema, the theater cinema. Then you have this like the object of this looping 35 millimeter projectors, which so like, and then you have this small like image. And also in the film itself, actually, the loop plays a very important role. And I so like was trying to create the different type of a space, which is like spherical, the spheres. Yeah. So there is like one person, which is, you will see like in one room, and actually describes his surroundings like to be actually the spheres of his own existence. So can we see the first film, please? The film is divided in three parts. First part is the time, the second part is the method, and the third part is untitled, but let's say it's life. Yes. It's only 6 minutes.
It's 11 o'clock in the morning. The flat has one room with an adjoining kitchen. A large window on the left, upon entering, dominates the space. Tree branches partially obstruct the window's view. V sits at the table and is looking at something on the floor. If someone were sitting across from him at the table and were looking in his direction, V's body would form a silhouette against the window, but the person would not see what V is looking at on the floor. No one else is sitting at the table anyway. The light, falling on the floor and part of the furniture, creates a figure in the shape of the window. This shape, moving across the space, determines the time and the tempo of the action in the flat. You can tell the time just by the shape's position on the floor. At least V can, since he spends most of the day staring at the three slowly moving rectangles. At 10 o'clock in the morning, if V is already up, the window's image has a three-dimensional shape. On the left side from V's perspective, the shape illuminates the edge of a couch covered by a blanket. It ends at the fourth parquet block to the right of the couch. At 11 o'clock, nearly the same shape of the window is shown on the floor, except that the left edge is bent somewhat and continues to illuminate the edge of the couch. Time stands still at night. It's night and then day again. In the morning, it's once again possible to tell the time. Or rather, an everyday activity that corresponds to a position. The fifth parquet block means it's time to wake up. The right leg of the chair, time for lunch. The necessity to determine the precise time would normally be linked to an event occurring outside the flat, but nothing V does has anything to do with what happens outside. No one has visited V for a long time, and he doesn't want to go and see anyone. Save for a few words when shopping, he doesn't say much during the day. The next morning, V counts the parquet blocks to see whether it's time to brush his teeth. He counts out loud, perhaps out loud, there's no one around to confirm this. The sun's rays penetrate through the window. The room is stuffy. If his mother were still alive, she'd regularly check up on V. She used to begin each visit by opening the window. V hates to have the window open. Another one of V's activities is to form various shapes from the different medicines on the table. He's set quite a few aside over the past few years. They differ in shape, color, illness that they treat, taste, chemical ingredients, shape of box, shape of bottle, and length of time that has elapsed from the date by which they should have been consumed. At first, positioning was derived from more apparent aesthetic properties. The first were colors, then shape. When he had used up most of the combinations, he began to take into consideration the arrangement of the pills on the table. On the table with regard to the room and so forth. It's late afternoon and V masturbates. The pills are spread out on the table in a 45-degree angle to the slant of the parquet. From left to right to the window, the pills are arranged according to a blue, purple, red, orange, yellow, white sequence. The pills create on the table a rectangular shape parallel to the table's edges. 30 minutes later, V collects from the rectangles the medicines of the anti-allergic group. Now the pills form a grid-like shape. He fidgets with the pills for a while in his palm. Purple is the predominant color. He begins to take one pill after another. When his palm is empty, he drinks them down and reaches for the pills on the left side of the window, the blue ones. The next day.
Next day. Doesn't matter. So the punchline is that, yeah, he was every day with everyone, with the other people. It was like the contrast between the sort of like the inner life and the life which is sort of like real. But like I was trying to sort of like show this like type of creating of this like the space through like thanks to like voiceover like that. So like also the method of how he creates this shape on the table was really sort of like based first on like the character of the pills itself, but then he started to sort of like create the shape like in regards to the room. And I mean like everything actually happens in this one room, and the window sort of like plays a very important role because it's so like the end of a sphere somehow. What is like, can we get back to the laptop, please? What is so like important is that I did like this exception in terms of like showing it here as a film, but like it must be always this films which I do is like must be always sort of like shown in the installations. No the other way. And then I actually created the Arab, wait for the image. No image. No, he doesn't sleep. Yes. So it's again, yeah. And then I sort of like my almost last work, which I want to talk about. It's sort of like I think it as a like second part of the film you've seen. It's the film installation. This is the floor plan of a gallery. The gallery Meyerigen Karlsruhe in Germany, and I was so like asked to so like create a solo show, and so I was thinking immediately on the film installation, and then I because the so like the history of the space was very interesting because the gallery started as a sort of like underground space, and they started with this like first space, and then when so like they started to so like doing well, so then always were able to rent more and more space, so they were growing through the building, and I was so like trying to so like work with the space like the way. So what is very important is that I wrote the script up to the floor plan, so that you have this like first part which is sort of like mutually connected, and then you have like this like distant part, which is so like in between, and those two parts is like the big office. So I created this like the story, which is like so like the fiction also like was the fiction the last thing? It was the first fiction I wrote, and is also the fiction. And it's like sort of like the two so like separate stories, which actually overlaps thanks to the sort of like the at the end with the sort of like punchline. What is important is that each, you know, you see this like red line, it means the projection. So each projection is again the character. So, and then like I use so like this type of like the sequence is that it starts like in the first room in like projection one. And then actually the story narration continues in the second room, and you actually are able to recognize it thanks to the sound, so you follow the sound, and then the third part is in the third projection, and then you suddenly sort of like travel through the space to sort of like be able to sort of like create somehow or to get this like narration, but the sequences are getting faster and faster, so suddenly you are not able to be in all sort of like places in once, of course, because it overlaps and it ends like at the end it's like all playing. So actually suddenly you have to always use your way how to sort of like see the film, which is for me very important thing, because like I really consider this like linear quality like the of like film, especially this entertainment film, Hollywood film, like as a sort of like also with sort of like very political sort of like notions to sort of like lead the people, you know, and this like this way when you sort of like decide how you see the story, and then you decide the system if you will sort of like stay in one room first and then you go to another one, or you follow the sound and then you actually wait a couple of loops before sort of like you will see the whole thing. It was very sort of like nice, and I'm finally, because I thought that someone will punch my nose when sort of like showing this like installation, because it was sort of like a little, could be sort of like understood as a sort of like manipulation a little bit with the people, but of course the initial idea is completely different. But like finally I was really surprised that like people were really like that, because the whole story was created like within this like space somehow. And what is important of course to say is that all it was simultaneous, so it was like all very important how it sort of like worked like together, because for instance in one moment one person was like talking to the other, and both were in the different rooms, so actually you had this dialogue through the rooms and stuff like that. So I mean we can see part of it, because like there is like I'm showing first this three tracks or three sequences, the three characters, and then the second one, which is so like the distant one is the so like the, for me it's like the same person as the Mr. V, which was in the previous film. And so like it's so like somehow for me in the next step how to so like talk about this solitude, let's say. So we can see the first part that you'll be able to understand how it worked, but unfortunately I have no images from the space, so you have to imagine it now. It's like the three screens on one. Can we see the second film, please?
Ivan calls his wife. They are planning a trip out of Prague for the weekend. They agree what time they will meet at home and what he has to buy for the journey. "Hi, how's it going? I've finished. I can be home in 20 minutes," he says. "How come? Why her again?" He finds out they are not going alone. The other is going with them as well. They know each other from trips together. The other is alone now. Her boyfriend left her recently, and Ava, his wife, takes her everywhere. After a while, he puts the phone down with an air of annoyance.
Get a move on, then. Bye, Eva answers Ivan. She got home early from work today and is packing. The other observes the landscape. It is as if the view from behind, or from a detached position, were her chief method of connecting to the surrounding happenings. Passivity of observation. A feeling interrupted by the intervention of adulthood. The order of the independent succession of events that has melted away. Observation then has the character of mere preparation for a decision. This order consisted of the activities of others, those whom the other once looked after. She looks as if she were thinking, for example, of a train journey. The destination of the journey is not yours, but that of someone who looks after you. He had decided to travel, he bought tickets. He knows how much time is left to the end, where the train is standing. And it is left to her to persevere inside the train, to observe the people around, sometimes to look out the window. She usually has 6 hours for this, the duration of the journey between Prague and Bratislava. Passages of time thus alternate in an environment, passages that almost do not have the quality of time. It is only a question of spaces and certain types of activity that have begun suddenly and just as suddenly end, and that is more about duration than getting closer. She looks as if she were thinking about whether things had ever occurred as she remembers them. There is no longer a single witness of that time who could confirm the past as she remembers it. The weekend. Eva is sitting with Ivan and the other at a table in a bar. The other is in a good mood. She keeps talking. The top of the table at which they sit is almost square in shape. Ivan sits opposite Eva. The other sits to his left. Or rather, the other two sit opposite him. They are right in front of Ivan, and he follows their conversation with his head movements. He holds his glass in his right hand and turns it slowly with his fingers. By the left side of his body, roughly at the same vertical level as his shoulder, lies a box of cigarettes. The cigarette box, together with the cigarette lighter, which is pointed towards his right wrist, form an inverted V. In front of Eva stands a glass that is not in contact with any part of her body, but aligned precisely in central position compared to Ivan's body. Eva's cigarettes are a little to the left of her glass from Ivan's perspective. If the axis of his right hand and the glass were to be extended, it would point at the other. In the center between Ivan and the other lies an ashtray. This forms the center of the whole composition, which is evident particularly from above, looking down diagonally on the table.
Ivan goes into a bar. They are supposed to wait there for him. He had to have something fixed on the car. There's no one here yet, though. He sits at the bar for a while. There's still no sign of Eva and the other. His eyes wander around the bar tables. It occurs to him that there could be a rear restaurant space and that he could miss them. He scans the walls of the room, his eyes searching for someone. Ivan returns to his old apartment.
Ivan has left Eva and begun living with the other.
Going upstairs, he opens the door. He has not lived in the apartment for a few weeks. He now has the possibility of seeing the place he once lived in as if from an outsider's viewpoint. The door opens to the left. It takes a few seconds for his eyes to get used to the dark entrance hall.
He's in the apartment several weeks later. He's collecting his things.
He closely examines the apartment.
The apartment is becoming empty.
Which he had lived for 15 years. I'll leave these books here. I hope you don't mind them, Ivan says.
Take what you want, Eva replies.
I'll go then. I'll be back for these boxes.
You can still change your mind.
I've made my mind up, he replies. He is overcome by a feeling of uncertainty, change. He knew his personal habits, all that makes up everyday life, the way in which he relaxes, what makes him laugh when he is behind closed doors. He is a little repulsed by himself.
Let's go, it's 11 o'clock. It'll be one by the time we get there, she says.
Several months later, Ivan's life has changed. Things he had always insisted on, he has now let go without a problem. He wears different clothes, has begun to do sports. He and the other have just bought new bikes. He prefers not to think about Eva. They had a number of terrible rows. Ivan had been feeling guilty. Eva hates the other. She blames her for everything that happened. Ivan's new life cost him a lot of effort.
It's morning. Eva decides she will not go out at all today. Suddenly the telephone rings in the next room. Eva goes to it. Hello, says the voice on the phone. Motol Faculty Hospital here. Are you Mrs. Eva, wife of Ivan? Yes, Eva replies. The voice on the other end cannot be heard in the apartment. It would be possible to substitute some random sound for the yes with which Eva replies to the question. Your husband is hospitalized here. He has just regained consciousness, says the voice on the phone. But the interior of the apartment is once again silent. What happened?
Motor hospital, please. The other, she looks at the surroundings through the window. The image of the surroundings passes with the speed of the car. She looks as if she were thinking about whether things had ever occurred as she remembers them. There is no longer a single witness of that time who could confirm the past as she remembers it. The time of the taxi ride has delineated for her an opportunity for quiet observation, which she is gradually losing. With an unpleasant feeling, she notices the surroundings, which remind her of the nearing end of the journey.
In the hospital.
She thinks about
Hello,
whether she should
nurse,
tell him.
Please don't tell him that I'm
Ivan,
here.
Ivan, after the accident, evidently forgot that he's no longer with his wife.
It's just that
it's
after
as if the
accident, the
time that
he doesn't
the other and
remember.
He had spent together never was.
Certainly, the nurse replies.
As soon as he regained consciousness, he asked for his wife.
Excuse me, nurse. Have you called my
you
wife?
You don't mind if I switch the radio on?
How is she?
The taxi driver asks.
When is she going to come and see me? You should do something, the nurse says. You just keep staring into space. I'll switch the radio on next. That's strange, she says after a while. That sounds like a fridge.
So, as you see, like those two actually were in the one room. The other was like in a second room, and like which is very important is that like always, you know, the sound belongs to a certain character. You know, you can recognize the there are three voices. So it was actually sometimes very nice to sort of like use the sound from the one character for the image somewhere else. Also, like there was like a chance to like sort of like fulfill this like observation of the object from like different points of view, which was this moment when so like there was like the one language situation like next to the table, and there were like the actually three cameras taking in the same moment the same situation. So I mean, like for me, this was actually all show look was like called a gap, which is this like sort of like this the gap which you have to sort of like create things to like yours like the yeah so like memory. And also like created this so like the story from these fragments which are playing in each in different room. I like this is sort of like the one of the last projects I did. Like I have a plan to actually continue with these two projects which you've seen, like one which was the projections, the projectors, 35 millimeters projectors. The other was the gap, this one, and the third is sort of like I was asked or to make like big outdoor sculpture in like private property in the middle of American, like the Hudson River Valley. So, and I my idea is to like to make like open air cinema, which will be like in the middle of sort of like forest, and it will play every day at 11 o'clock, even no one is there. So it's sort of like, again, so like somehow like talk with this like spectacularity of the film, and also with this like, what is this position of spectator and what is the so like relation between the image and the spectator. So that's the third thing. And last thing which I did, which sort of like yesterday, it was one of the replies, a theater play. So thanks to the films, I started to work with the actors, and like suddenly the narration has completely like again like new sort of like role, because you also like work with the actor, like which is so like also fulfilling the or embodying the characters in the story. And this like actually then from the films I started to sort of like work with the real actors. And in Frankfurter Kunstverein I used the stairs, which is the sort of like the space, this blank space again of the institutions, as this was like or for instance in this the spider, this like text piece. And I divided the story again into sequences, like five sequences, as the stairs were structured, like ground floor, mid floor, first floor, mid floor, the second floor. And they are sort of like the sequences, like, I mean, like there is also like the standing of people in certain sort of like the sphere or in a certain space. And when people are coming sort of like randomly, because we said like it will be like the play will be in between like 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. So as people are coming like randomly, they always like if they will sort of like cross the decided point on the floor, the actors will start to act. So when they sort of like go up to the stairs, they sort of like can see the whole play, and also sort of like to to get like the whole narration with it, also with a sort of like very absurd punchline at the end. And what is interesting in it, so like is again, so like the working with is like the sequences of narration, which sort of like is also dealing with this memory and how you actually dramatize your memory. But also, what is very interesting is sort of like that because like the sequences are posed in a different space, like always in a different place. So I mean, the main character, which is like in each sequence, actually is like represented by different actor, of course. And that's a very interesting thing, because then you actually have to think what is the identity of the character. Of course, like very important role plays this like voiceover, they speak, of course, and they have dialogues. But also, for instance, the cloth, you know, so actually it's sort of like discover certain things which are very important for the theater. Or also I was asking to sort of like collaborate with the like theater actors, not like for instance with the art students and stuff, because like I wanted to sort of like also like work a little bit with this like experience or these habits of the theater when they sort of like a little bit overplay, but it's not necessary because not the stage is not the space between the spectators and the stage, so the gesture suddenly has a completely different role, which is like virtual, for instance. And also in this film last, like what you've seen last, this gap, it was very so like nice way, because like suddenly when you, for instance, use the sound from the like one character to sort of like actually influence the image which is in the room, so you sort of like discover the layers of how actually the like film is so like build it up, which actually is very interesting. So that's my work. So like it's almost everything I can say now. So thank you for your coming, and if you have a discussion, have questions, so please, I'm here.
Digest all that. Any questions? It's hard to digest, they usually sound immediately.
Yeah. I'm but it's a real floor plan of the gallery. Yeah, but like yeah, it is. Yeah, that's what I said. Is that the whole so like story was written up to the sort of like the floor plan of the gallery. What is important also on this film is that like I was not talking about this like distant character. He's like again the person who is sort of like closed in his space, and like because he sort of like has to sort of like somehow organize his sort of like surroundings and also his life. So he starts to sort of like use a fridge as a something what structures the time. So he has like notebooks, and then he actually signs always when it's like refrigerator is going, like the sound of the refrigerator or the cooling cycle is on and off, and it's always signs this like the numbers. So actually this is the so like something what overlaps this first part, which is the story about this tree, actually tree love triangle, and then it like ends absurd, and actually they on like all like switch the radio on, and there is like the sound of the fridge. And it's this guy who's sort of like counting the cooling cycles, So, but like, what is important is that also the theater I mentioned, and also this sort of like the floor plan is always like, I always work with the floor plan as a sort of like something with its initial, you know, and then that's also like influence the whole story. Always. I mean, like. Of course, sometimes actually the piece itself so like creates the quality of the space where it is shown. For instance, this rubber, yeah. So it's sort of like the opposite way, but it's sort of maybe the two directions I have like. Yeah. There was a.
Curious about use the term spherical space.
Spherical space. Well, it's sort of like, you know, it's like always like sort of like trying to, this is not of course my notion, but I try to always sort of like figure out like the different ways how you can sort of like think on for instance the space, or and I think the if you have this, we have this sort of like Cartesian space, so the spherical one is like very different. I think it's also a little bit like it's in some like controversy with the sort of like the European type of thinking on the space, is this spherical, which is more, I would say, like, yeah, from the different cultural context. And as very, I mean, for me, it has completely different character, because also the, how you think about, like, the, for instance, the principles, like, when you so like compare this Cartesian space and the spheric art, like completely different. So there I was like trying to so like in the screen plane to create this type of like space, which is so like the person, the individual, then it's like this immediate surroundings, which actually is trying to so like understand through the method of these pills and stuff like that. And then it's like the room, and there is something that is out of the room, which is so like then over like at the end, which we didn't have. So like shown that there was also the space like out of the room.
So you use that concept just for this project?
Yeah.
And does it apply to the theater project?
I mean, the theater project is a bit different because then actually, I mean, it's the space already existing is not like very like this like the space like virtual one like or the, but it's like existing space of the gallery. So I mean, it has a little bit different character, and also it deals with the linearity, which is sort of like very important because you sort of like walk like this, and it has certain sort of like, yeah, it has a different quality than the sphere. Yeah, it is, as I said, like there is like so like a development. Like first, I was so like very like interested in this like usual, this like everyday stories, which so like always I heard from the very clear close people, like friends or family, and then I started to so like create a fiction, which is completely different type of like work. Yeah, and of course it's so like important, but like it's like for me always like. The content of the text or content of the story and the, so like the physical realization is always like two parts I work with like separately first and then trying to so like them like to so like connect somehow so yeah and now yeah, of course it's important and like for instance the one which is like this like 35 millimeters projector so it's like really looping because it's sort of like yeah living in his own so like space without his like being able to understand that he's like among the people. So it's this loop, you know, so it's sort of like called, it's like deals with the whole setup of the, and also this like, I mean, the story of this tree is like this like love triangle when he hits his head and forgets that he had an affair with the and so it's up to these two women to tell him that he had an affair. So to reconstruct is like the past is also a gap, yeah, so it's sort of like, it's supposed to embody somehow the physical or formal way.
Could you give us a flavor of the difference in the narrative for the actors in the theater?
Yeah, it's sort of like it's again deals with a sort of like the theater itself. So the story is about like there is a party. And suddenly, like the main character is in a party a little bit, so like again, it's like with this like existential position. So he knows everyone, but no one is really close to him. And suddenly, like one like woman will sort of like approach him and tell him that in a room there is one person who is an actor, and the role of the actor is to play one of us. That no one will recognize that the actor is playing. So he starts to observe the surroundings differently because he sort of like suspect everyone that is the actor, so and it has certain development and when sort of like his reality totally sort of like deconstructs. So again, so like the content of the story is very important in terms of how it deals with the formal way of working with it. Yeah. That's sort of like yeah, very important thing, and yeah, as I said, like for me, like first was like very simple fact, you know, that the way how we read, you know, it really so like organize the space, and but it's so like no escape, you know, you so always have to think about this like, yeah, the direction, which also very very much deals, I think, with like this traditional construction of the image in the sort of like yeah, let's say Western history of art, somehow. And then actually, then I sort of like, I really, for me, it's very sort of like important this like several ways how you can actually, for instance, in a text installation, how you can work with this like the text, because then you have like one, you have like the linear sort of like way. Then you have like this hypertext, which is sort of like it's always developing, and you cannot read it again the same way almost because it's sort of like always like choosing. Then you have this like it's linear, but you can always sort of like switch. So like you have like several, so it's also different. And then you have, for instance, this which we used with the Jonas, which sort of like actually then you are based on the light, which actually somehow manipulates again the way. But then, for instance, in this theater, then I realized that what it, like the manipulation is like. That it, because it's sort of like set up was so like this five sequences, and it was very like first when you see so the first sequence, it was so like normal, it was not stage, but it was so like situation, like spectator and the actors, and then actually you had to move, and there was sort of like the people were doubting, so I invented the actor who was like one of us, who was like standing in among the people, and he was moving, yeah. Which is very so like interesting, because then you can so like create whatever you want, you know. You can so like create as difficult so like setup or floor plan of the like whole thing as you want, because like when you have someone who actually manipulates with the people walking, so there was like very funny things then that the guy was then like doing like fun and walking somewhere like to office, and everyone was like following him, you know. So actually. That's also very, yeah, it has certain, you know, yeah, quality of, like, I always talking about, like, the political quality, you know, but because, like, I have a little bit different experience, you know, where I was, sort of, like, growing up in the, like, 80s or 70s, 80s, and, like, communism, and there, actually, everything, I mean, like, if you, sort of, like, that society was based on that everything must be political, but, sort of, like, official political, official, sort of, like, way of political so like thinking, so it was sort of like this propaganda communism, so like all opposition was based on like that they were apolitical, and it was very political, so like meaning, you know. So for us, everything which is sort of like everything, like for me, most important notion in terms of like politics is like myself, of course, because this is the first unit of like the sort of like society somehow. So that's why I'm using the this like notion of political, because I think that it's sort of like discovers the structure how we behave like when like in a society somehow, and this manipulation is like very so like a dangerous thing, and also in when you work, for instance, like in the framework of like cinematography, you have this like, you know, for instance, Chaplin was really working with this like reaction of audience, and he was like editing his like so like films up to so like how the like the spectators were so like reacting on like this rough material. So there is like actually a lot of things which you can sort of like call like manipulation, and it's a very interesting thing, I have to say. I mean, yeah. So thank you then.